questions.
You do whatever you want. You're running that end of the show, sir. I'm just here to respond. Way back in the primitive days I'm talking about, there was no place where you could go and learn to be a record producer. You did it.
Cannonball and I, we were on a tour when we played in Indianapolis, which is Wes Montgomery's home. They told us this guitar player would be playing after hours. He didn't start until 2 o'clock in the morning. And it was a barbecue joint that he was playing in. When we went to hear Wes Montgomery and had the barbecue, it was so remarkable that we called Orrin Keepnews at our record company that morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, said, "You've got to come out here and hear this man play with this vibrancy and was something entirely new. He was playing and he was playing in these octaves." And we just sat there and listened and said, "My goodness." And then to find out that he really didn't know, he never learned to read music. We studied in the universities, how to be a correct musician. And you can't imagine how it makes you feel to say, "I studied all of that and I don't know anything about what this man is doing."
Riverside Wes Montgomery album. And the first one had been a matter of bringing him and the other members of his then working trio. He was doing an organ trio bit at that point. One of the problems in life was bringing musicians in to town. Frequently what I would do is I would bring somebody in, attempt to have him do an album as a leader and also an album as a featured sideman with somebody else on the same trip. In this particular case, Wes Montgomery was still living in Indianapolis. It was time for his second album. Also, Nat Adderley, who was always doggedly in search of unusual instrumentation, wanted to do an album with a three-person front line consisting of himself, that's not trumpet, but cornet, cello, which Sam Jones was playing, and guitar. And I thought it was a pretty damn intriguing idea. And it was not only the instrumentation that intrigued him, but he was, you know, pretty specific about working with those people. I took upon myself, who else was going to do it, the logistical necessity. You bring Wes in, you do the two albums, the next Wes Montgomery album and the particular Nat Adderley album, you do them kind of wrapped around each other. And that is what we did. I still don't know whether it was a good idea or not, but both albums turned out pretty damn well. The whole idea of that band was that I wanted as compatible and as unpressured, I guess, a rhythm section for him as possible. And what I was looking for was something that would let me be sufficiently flexible, because the danger with somebody like Wes, who was, you know, was a great blues player, was getting too one-dimensional, getting trapped into presenting him as a funky blues guitar player, when he was probably, more than anything else, a supreme melodist, and also had these incredible, to use the word, stylistic devices. Wes playing octaves. Wes playing the kind of chords that he played, which were, you know, things that you were not supposed to be able to do on the guitar, and which literally he did because he didn't know you weren't supposed to do them. Wes was a basically self-taught player. He really learned a hell of a lot by as a teenager listening to Charlie Christian records. And of course, and he was a great self-deprecator. He was fond of saying, "You should have heard me a few years ago when I was really playing." There is a tendency in my career to come across these people who you have to kind of drag it out of them or get them to be the last one to admit that they're really doing it. Wes, actually with Wes, it got to be almost a standing joke. Wes always wanted to do another take because he didn't quite have it yet. I had, by the time I got to work with Montgomery, I was had developed a recording sheet system of my own, that a way in which I, on a card that I had devised, noted immediate reaction to each individual take. I would go back and look at those things over the years, and on Wes Montgomery dates, I'll frequently find the notation, WM doesn't like his solo. And we'll go on and do it again. And on one classic situation, on a take which did turn out to be the last take, I had written, WM doesn't like his solo, but everyone else does. What I remember is offering Sonny a standard royalty, a 5% royalty. And Sonny refused to take a royalty. Oh, wait a minute, you know Sonny well enough that you will get the picture here. Sonny said, in just about so many words, "Look, I consider you guys friends of mine right now. If we sign a royalty deal, sooner or later I'll become convinced that you're cheating me, and I don't want that to happen."